Can you hear me, Harry? Can you hear me? Am I sounding good? Okay, good. Thanks.
Good morning, church. Good morning, church. Please, can we all rise? I want you to go around and say good morning to your neighbor with a big smile like mine. This is the day the Lord has made. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, it says, "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." Amen. So no matter what you're going through, no matter the heavy loads you're carrying, the Bible says, "Come unto me." It doesn't matter how long you have been carrying that load, the childlessness you're facing, the sickness in your body, the Bible says, "Come unto me, all those that labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest." You know why? Because in the presence of God, there is fullness of joy. So whatever you're believing God for, this morning, I want you to tap into that anointing that is present in this service. Amen. So we're going to trade everything to God. We're going to trade our sorrows. We're going to trade our worries. We're going to trade our tomorrow. Everything we're going to trade. Amen. Hallelujah. Put those beautiful hands together for the Lord. Amen, church. Amen. I can't hear you. Amen, church.
Amen.
Amen. Joy of the Lord. Yeah. I'm trading my sickness. I'm trading my pain. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Though the sorrow may last for a night, joy comes in the morning. I'm trading my sorrow.
I'm trading my shame.
I'm trading my shame.
I'm laying it down.
I'm laying it down for the joy of the Lord.
I'm trading my sickness.
I'm trading my sickness.
I'm trading. To the King of Glory, the one that holds it all in his hands. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter what your tomorrow will be, he holds it all in his hands. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
My world.
And You won't let go of me. You won't let go of me. You won't let go. Never let go. Sing. You won't let go of me. No, 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 no. You won't let go of me. I'm safe in your hands.
You won't let go of me.
Because you hold our world in your hands. That is the blessed assurance that we have in you. That you hold it all, no matter what we are going through. You hold our future in your hands. Thank you, Jesus. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Hallelujah. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine, and oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. I'm an heir of salvation. I'm purchased of God. I'm born of His Spirit, and I'm washed in His blood. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my
submission.
Come on, just sing it.
All is at rest.
Surrender it to you, Jesus, this morning. Take us, oh God. Take everything, oh God, in us, oh God, Jesus. Take our inabilities, oh God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Of you, my King, I'm giving you my dreams, laying down my rights, giving up my pride for the promise of new life. And I
surrender all to you. All I love for the sake of knowing you, for the glory of your name, to know the lasting joy, even sharing in your pain.
Surrender. giving you my heart and all that is within. I lay it all down for the sake of you, my King. I'm giving you my dreams, laying down my rights, giving up my pride for the promise of new life. Hallelujah. We surrender it all to you. We surrender it all. I surrender it all to you. Ancient of days. Surrender it all. I surrender my future to you. Have your way, oh God. I surrender my job. I surrender my pain. I surrender it to you. Oh, in your presence, Lord. In your presence, Lord, there is fullness of joy. Oh, I surrender all to you.
Let's sing it one more time. I surrender all.
And I
church, lift your voice, lift your hands to him.
I surrender all to you. I surrender all to you. All to you.
One more time, surrender it all.
God that answers prayers.
You know our heart cry this morning, oh God. You see us when we cry in our rooms. You know our griefs. You know our pains. You know our sorrow, Jesus. That's why we surrender it to you. You know our future. You hold our world in your hands. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. As we continue the service, oh God, I pray, oh God, your spirit, oh God, we deposit something in us, something that would change us for good in the name of Jesus. Lord, as your word comes forth this morning, I pray it will come forth with power, oh God. It will penetrate every heart this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I just want us to say thank you, Jesus. Wave your hands and say thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name we worship. Let us remain standing for the reading of God's word. Amen.
Good morning, church. Today's scripture reading is taken from Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 to 13. This, then, is how you should pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. This is the word of the Lord.
church. Good morning, church. There we are. Good morning, church. This morning, I'm going to take the part of the Lord's Prayer, lead us not into temptation. Jim will return to give us our daily bread next week. And my goal this morning in exploring this scripture is to explore how to interrupt the leading of temptation in our lives. Petition says, Lord, yours is the kingdom. You're on the throne. I want you on the throne of my life. So being on the throne of my life, I ask that you would, Lord, lead me not into temptation and please deliver me from the evil. Now, to think about this, I want you to think about your heart for a minute. The heart, Pastor Jim mentioned this too, that the Bible never separates body, soul, and spirit. But that's a Greek idea. It's not a biblical idea. The Hebrews and the New Testament always looked on us as a human being as a complete entity. And it describes this by the use of the word heart. So the heart, your heart, makes up everything about you that enables you to make a decision. So it's your mind, it's your feelings, it's your personality, it's the way you remember things, it's all these things make up your heart. It's your governing center. Now I can prove to you this is true. When you get nervous, which is your head thinking and worrying and wondering what to do, often you have a bodily reaction, right? Because your mind is hooked to your body. Now, my major thing, if I'm really nervous, is I get really wet pits, okay? So the first time I preached, I'll never forget it. I was so stinking nervous. I was wet all the way down to here, okay? Now, that just adds to the problem. You're in front of hundreds of people preaching for the first time, and here's this wet mark going down your shirt. It's very embarrassing. Perhaps some of you get butterflies in your stomach. Did anybody get butterflies in your stomach? Or perhaps you get cold, sweaty palms, okay? In other words, it's showing you that everything is connected, right? So temptation targets your whole heart. So the summary of the two commandments are love the Lord your God with all your heart, which means you love him with your memories. You let the Lord have your memories of the things you've done wrong and let him forgive your memories. Love the Lord your God with who you are, your personality. You're unique. Love God with who you are. You can't love God with who you aren't. You got to love God with who you are. If you're outgoing, love God in an outgoing way. If you're a little more introverted, well, love God in that way. Love God with all your heart. Okay? And love your neighbor as yourself. So, but we got a problem. And that's, Jeremiah points out, the heart is deceitful above all things, and who can understand? Our own hearts can deceive us and lead us astray. And they do it all the time. That's why we're led into temptation. And part of the problem is our own hearts. Our own hearts deceive us. They trick us. They deceive us, and they lead us into temptation. So we pray the prayer, Lord, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, reign in my heart. I want you to reign me. I want you to be Lord over my thoughts, my feelings, my actions. Lord, reign in me more and more. I think that's a song we sang last week, maybe. Lord, reign in me. In me. In my heart. But the problem is that old heart deceives us. So we have to think about how not to be led into temptation. And part of it is interrupting the seeing and the sending in my own heart. Okay? What I see, what I send for. Okay? We got to interrupt the things that I search for in my own heart. Because that's what temptation is. It's leading us to search for something and to grab something and to want something. And of course, the classic example in Scripture is the example of David in 2 Samuel 11 and 12. So let's turn to that. Let me get to that part of my tablet here. And it's going to have to load. It always does that. I use Bible, Olive Tree Bible, great app if you want to download it. And in Olive Tree, you can underline, take notes, have side-by-side comparisons, have four or five Bibles open at once. It's a great battle. So in 2 Samuel 11, David's kingdom is finally in place. And David is in his palace in Jerusalem, and it's the springtime, at the time when kings go off to war. But this time, David's heart just isn't into it. He's just not into being that kind of king right now. So he sends his armies off without him, and they go to destroy the Ammonites, and they besiege Rabbath, but David remained in Jerusalem. And one evening, in this bored state where he has nothing to do, David got up from his bed, and he walked on the roof of the palace. And this idea of walking, you had this sense that he's walking around. You know, he's just kind of got nothing else to do. Nothing to occupy his heart, his mind, his thinking. So he's walking around on his roof. And from the roof, he saw a woman bathing. And the woman was very beautiful. And David, from the look to the stare to the concentration, begins to occupy his heart. Now, note that we saw the word sent up in verse 1, and now we see it again down in verse 3. The sent word in this passage will alert us to the further leading into temptation, which leads him further into evil. The more he sins, the more he searches, the more he grabs for, the deeper and deeper he gets into evil. So he sins, he inquires about this woman. And the man said, she is Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite. And again, David sent messengers to get her. She came to him, and he slept with her. Now she was purifying herself from her monthly uncleanness, which tells us two things. One, she's clean. She is concerned about holy rituals. And two, she's not pregnant. Then she went back home. And David doesn't care. So he's led into temptation. He gives in to temptation. And then the woman conceived. And again, we see the word sent. She sent word back to David saying, I'm pregnant. So every time we see this word sent, more and more bad things begin to happen. David doesn't know when to say stop. So David sent word because he sees the only way to deal with his having been led into temptation, giving into temptation, having the fruit of his temptation come forward is to now try to cover it up. So he sent word to Joab, send me Uriah the Hittite. And Joab sent him to David. When Uriah came to him, David asked him how Joab was, how the soldiers were, and how the war was going. Now notice something interesting here. He doesn't even listen to what Uriah says. Why is that? Where is David's heart right now? Is he concerned about Uriah? Is he concerned about what's going on in the battlefield? Is he concerned about anything else? Who's David concerned about? Himself. So he's trying to cover up his own mistakes. Oh Lord, lead me not into temptation. Oh Lord, please interrupt this crazy pattern I now have myself tumbling into. He keeps sending for things. He keeps giving in to what he sends to. And then he's blinded by it. And it keeps getting deeper and deeper. So he says to Uriah, go down to your house and wash your feet. So Uriah left the palace, and even a gift from the king was sent to him. Because he's trying to lure Uriah to being with his wife. Because if Uriah is with his wife, then obviously he's the father of whoever is born in 9 months. He's trying to cover his tracks. But Uriah slept at the entrance to the palace with all his master's servants and did not go down to the house. David was told Uriah didn't go home. So he asked Uriah, haven't you just come from a military campaign? Why don't you go home? Go home. Uriah, go home. That's where I sent you. Go home. And Uriah said to David, the ark and Israel and Judah are staying in tents, and my commander Joab and my Lord's men are camped in the open country. How could I go to the house and eat and drink and make love to my wife? As sure as you live, I will not do such a thing. He's more aware of the condition of the troops of the king's army and more concerned about the troops and the king's army than the king is. Because the king keeps being led into temptation, keeps being led into selfishness, keeps being deceived by his own heart, so he can't even see what's going on. Then David said to him, stay here one more day, and tomorrow I will send you back. So Uriah remained in Jerusalem that day and the next, and at David's invitation, he ate and drank with him, and David even got him drunk. But in the evening, Uriah went out to sleep on his mat among his master's servants, and he did not go home. It's not working. So will David stop? Will David now not be led into further temptation, into further evil? Or will he allow his heart to be even more deceived, even more led into even greater evil? Lord, lead me not into temptation. Lord, protect me from the evil one. But in the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it. We see the word send again. He sent the letter. And in the letter, he wrote, put Uriah out in front where the fighting is fiercest, then withdraw from him so he will be struck down and die. Now he's being now led into the temptation of killing someone else to cover up for his own problem. So being led into temptation, giving into evil, leads to even more temptation, leads to even more giving into even more evil, and it just keeps tumbling along here. So while Joab had the city under siege, he put Uriah at a place where he knew the strongest defenders were. When the men of the city came out and fought against Joab, some of the men in David's army fell. Moreover, Uriah the Hittite died. Joab sent David a full account of the battle. He instructed the messenger, when you have finished giving the king this account of the battle, the king's anger may flare up, and he may ask you, why did you get so close to the city to fight? Didn't you know they would shoot arrows from the wall? He's hoping David's conscience will be somehow affected by this. And then he mentions this, which is very interesting. He goes back to the book of Judges. And he says, who killed Abimelech, son of Jerubbaal? Didn't a woman drop an upper millstone on him from the wall? He mentions a woman. Do you think Joab knows something? Do you think Joab perhaps knows why David is trying to cover up? Perhaps he knows a woman is involved. Perhaps he knows why Uriah the Hittite was placed in the jeopardy of what he was placed in and why he needed to cover up and why he needed to kill it. Even his general can see what's really going on here. The messenger set out, and when he arrived, he told David everything Joab had sent him to say. The messenger said to David, the men overpowered us and came out against us in the open, but we drove them back to the entrance of the city gate. Then the archers shot arrows at your servants from the wall, and some of the king's men died. Moreover, your servant Uriah the Hittite is dead. And David told the messengers, say this to Joab, don't let this upset you. Don't let it upset you. It doesn't upset me. In fact, I'm kind of grateful. Finally covered it up. He's been led into this deception. See, when we're led into temptation, when we're led into evil, if we don't check it, if we don't repent of it, it keeps leading us deeper and deeper into greater temptation, into greater evil, into greater giving in, and it just keeps tumbling in and in and in. This process of being led into temptation, giving into evil, more and more evil needs to be interrupted. The sword devours one as well as another. Press the attack against this city and destroy it. Say this to encourage Joab. When Uriah's wife heard that her husband was dead, she mourned for him. After the time of mourning was over, David had her brought to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing David had done displeased the Lord. What does the Lord do? What do you do with David, who has been so led into temptation? We see the verb sent in sin is used 11 different times in 2 Samuel. And with each sending, we see greater and greater leading into temptation. We see even greater evil being a fruit of what happens. With each sending, the fruits of giving into temptation and evil. But then we have a divine interruption, which is God's grace. The Lord sends Nathan to David. Let's go back to Sam. So after all of this happens, the Lord sent Nathan to David. Now, why would he do that? Who is Nathan? He's the prophet. What does a prophet do? He speaks the word of God. Now David is no ordinary king, right? David is the king of Israel. Who appointed David king? The Lord. So he's the Lord's man. So he's accountable to whom? To God himself. So if Jesus is on the throne of our hearts, if Jesus is our Lord, and we say, Jesus, reign in me, who are we accountable to? Who do we want reigning in our hearts? We want the Lord. So if we have this pattern of searching and sending for evil things, and we give in to temptations, and we keep being drawn deeper and deeper into bad situations, this is exactly what we want. We want a divine interruption. Oh, Lord, interrupt my life. Please stop this crazy pattern in my life. So the Lord sent Nathan to David, and when he came to him, he said, there were two men. He does it with a story. I just love it. He tells a story. There were two men in a certain town, and one was rich and the other was poor. And the rich man had a very large number of sheep and cattle. But the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb he had bought. He raised it, and it grew up with him and his children. He shared his food and drank from his cup and even slept in his arms. It was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man refrained from taking one of his own sheep or cattle to prepare a meal for the traveler who had come to him. Instead, he took the ewe lamb that belonged to the poor man, and he prepared it for the one who came to him. And David burned with anger against the man and said to Nathan, as surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this has died. He recognized it. Victor's smiling up here because he played David in we did this last year, and then I was Nathan, and I said, you are the man. Yeah, okay. So he must pay for the lamb four times over because he did such a thing and had no pity. Then Nathan said to David, you are the man. David, you are the man. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. I anointed you king over Israel, and I delivered you from the hand of Saul. I gave your master's house to you and your master's wives into your arms. I gave you all of Israel and Judah, and if that had been too little, I would have given you even more. Why did you despise the word of the Lord by doing what is evil in his eyes? You struck down Uriah the Hittite with a sword and took his wife to be your own. You killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now, therefore, the sword will never depart from your house, because you despise me, and you took the wife of Uriah to get that. David, we got to interrupt this crazy pattern in your life. It's crazy. You got to repent. You got to stop. There's still consequences for this being led into temptation, being led into evil, and giving in and tumbling deeper and further in. But the Lord interrupts, and this is grace. Matthew 26:41, Jesus said to his disciples in the Garden of Gethsemane, just before he was taken off to be crucified, Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but your flesh is weak. You're going to be deceived. You're going to be led. Oh Lord, interrupt my searching and seeking. What searches are taking place in your heart right now? If you look at your heart and the things you search for, the things you seek, the things you desire, the things that occupy you as you walk back and forth on the roof, when you're alone, what kind of things does your heart search for? Do you need to have any of those things interrupted? Okay? Do you need a Nathan? Do you need someone to come to you and say, stop? What are you thinking about? What are you searching? What occupies your heart and mind that leads to actions? What needs to be interrupted? Because that's the prayer. Lead me not into temptation is really saying, Lord, interrupt my thought process. Interrupt my actions. Interrupt the things that are keeping my heart from loving you with everything that I am. Lord, interrupt that. This would be one of mine. Searching for more stuff I really don't need. Anybody got that similar problem on Amazon? Yes, Ray. We are brothers in the searching for things we don't need. Is Gina here? And Denise is here. Just close your ears right now. La, 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 la. Just ignore that, Denise. I'm not sure I'm ready to give that one up yet. Okay? All right. Good. Why do we do that? Why do we do that? I don't know, because it's cool, right? I don't know. I have no idea. I already know what I want getting next, don't you? Do you have your wish list on Amazon? Yep, I do too. Yeah, you have four things in your wish list. You don't even want to see my wish list. Okay. Why is that? Now, if we're going to stop this pattern, this is what we need. If anyone serves the Lord, they should do so with the strength God provides. So that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ, to him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. The whole point is, if I'm in charge of my heart, it ain't going to be pretty. Because my heart will deceive me. My heart will search for the wrong things. My heart will go after everything else but the Lord. I need the Lord to be the strength of my heart. I need the strength God provides. Otherwise, I will be led into temptation. And the evil one will trick me and deceive me and take me where I don't want to go. If you serve the Lord, do so with the strength he provides. Keep yielding to him. Part of the prayer, the P-R-A-Y, the last one is yield. You need to yield. Lord, I can't control my own heart, so I yield to you. Lord, the only way I'm not going to be led into temptation is if I do it with the strength you provide. So here's a prayer for you. I want you to pray this week. It's from Psalm 94. It's one of those interrupt my thought process prayers, okay? Who will rise up for me against the wicked? Who will take a stand for me against evildoers? Unless the Lord had given me help, I would have soon dwelt in the silence of death. When I said, my foot is slipping, your unfailing love, Lord, supported me. When anxiety was great within me, your consolation brought me joy. Can a corrupt throne be allied with you? A throne that brings misery by its decrees? So if on the throne of your life, and you sit on your own throne, I'm Lord of me, and I get to search for what I want. Thank you very much, because I'm Lord of my own life. I sit on the throne. The last thing you want someday is in judgment, Jesus coming up to you and saying to you, get off my chair. Get off my chair. I'm supposed to be on the throne of your life, and you're sitting in the throne thinking you're Lord of your own life. Lord, can a corrupt throne be allied with you? No, it can't. If Jesus is Lord, Jesus is Lord. He needs to sit on the throne of our hearts. The wicked band together against the righteous and condemn the innocent to death. But the Lord has become my fortress and my God in the rock in whom I take refuge. He will repay them for their sins and destroy them for the wickedness. The Lord our God will destroy them. We need the Lord on the throne of our lives. We need the Lord to interrupt those thoughts that lead us into temptation. So be still before the Lord. Let's do that right now. Just be still before the Lord. And Lord, we listen to you in this time of prayer. We listen to your word, Lord. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your will, Lord, reign over us. Reign in our hearts, Lord Jesus. We give you everything that makes up who we are, our thoughts, our feelings, our memories, both good and bad. We give you our personalities. We give you our weaknesses. We give you our tendencies to be vulnerable to certain kinds of temptations. We give you the sins we've committed, and we ask your forgiveness. We give you our vulnerabilities, and we ask that you would lead us not into temptation, but you would be the strength of our hearts, that we would not be led by the evil one, that we would not be deceived. Lord, be the strength of our hearts, that we might serve you with joy and with gladness. Lord, sit on the throne of our hearts. Your kingdom come, Lord. Your will be done. For we ask this in Jesus' name. So interrupt me, Lord. That needs to be your cry this week. Interrupt me. Stop this crazy thought process. And respond to the Lord in prayer. And may you be blessed as the Lord strengthens you in your heart, that he might reign in your life. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Keith, for that terrific message. Wow. Lord, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. At this time, we will continue to worship the Lord by the giving of his tithes and our offerings. I invite the ushers to come up to receive the offering. And during the offertory, we have a special praise dance for you. A praise dance from the African church.
Amen. Yeah, we're going to do a song which says, "My God is good, oh, everything na double, double." It means God blesses you double, double. Can I hear you say double, double? Your blessing, double, double. Anointing, double, double. Favor, promotion,
double, double.
Amen.
Praise God. I think we followers of Jesus are a bunch of joyous crazies, huh? Praise God. We now receive our offering. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we can never outgive you because you've given us so much. And Lord, we thank you for the chance to express the joy of the Lord, which is our strength. Father, we thank you for this offering and pray that you would use it for your purposes to bring honor and glory and praise to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May these offerings be used to fulfill his mission in our world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please, can we all rise for the last song? Double, double. Amen. Hey, my God is good, oh.
I will sing. Turn around.
Somebody scream! Now take it as high as you can. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Double, 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 double.
Blessing, thank you.
Oh,
let's say one more thanks to Blessing. Yeah. Amen. We've placed a travel ban on you, and you're not able to travel. I just wanted to break the bad news to you and Donnie. So, okay, it's all good. It's all good. All right. Now this is a two-part benediction. We're going to have a lot of joy today. I'll give the scripture benediction, and then the high school is going to give you a send-off. So we got one more send-off to go. So let us, first of all, the benediction. And now to him, our God, who is able to keep you from stumbling, who is able to present you blameless before our Lord and Jesus, our Savior, to him be the glory and the dominion and the power forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
Dark and cold, there is a spirit who brings a fire, ignites a candle, and makes his home. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out the hopeless, confused and your world, take your candle. he's tried to light his own candle some other way. See now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to, still holds a candle without a
What an amazingly talented congregation this is. I thank you so much for closing us with that beautiful praise dance. Praise God. Let's just acknowledge them. And friends, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen.